Cool. So I would like to pray, if we could, before I get into things. Heavenly Father, we are reminded each day that the greatness that is within us is because the power of your Holy Spirit is at work and resident within us. As I even just reflect on the last couple of days, in many ways, including physical ailment, just I see the attack of the evil one, and I believe that that's directly linked with the messages that I'll be delivering starting today. So Holy Spirit, I ask that you'd speak through me to your people what you desire to come forth. I pray it'd be a time of upgrade that would bring clarity and insight. God, I pray that it would bring forth many conversations even after the messages amongst us, that it would stir us up. May your will be done in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'll kind of begin where I began last time that I preached, which was in the bathroom. So I figured I'd just start there. But for those who were here, you would remember that I talked about how my kids love to just come in. When we're in there, they would frantically cry about that and all that sort of stuff. But then God's got a sense of humor, so he kind of upgraded that, and it's now more like, can I sit on your lap when you're in there? And so I don't know what's next. I really don't, but God's pretty funny. So he's just in the small things, and even moments like that, I just think to God, I'm like, I love the fact that our relationship with him is intimate, and that I can see him in the small things. So just wanted to, Mel started to hit on this. I'm opening a series today called Creating a Culture of Honor. And so it's gonna be over 3 weeks, but what I'm gonna try to do today, and I've got a lot, and I'll just say that there will be a shift through the 3 weeks, so stay with me. But today I'm really gonna try to give a lot of foundational definition to phrases. What does culture of honor even mean? And fivefold ministry and just different things. But as we go forth next week, we're going to be focusing, today's more on forming our foundation, and that's the title of today's message. But next week it's what do and what don't we stand for. And so we're really going to get into things at a much deeper level as we look at seven mountains, as we look at fivefold ministry, as we look at prophetic and apostolic ministries, as we look at things that could bring great reservation and great confusion. I'm going to try to debunk the things that we don't stand for and magnify the things that we do stand for. And then in the third week, we're going to be able to put this kind of into divine motion. I'm going to give opportunity for us to basically take a lot of what I've taught and put it into action live with one another. And so that's kind of the journey that we're going to walk. So I wanted to just take a reflection. You can obviously, for those that have great vision or are close, you might be able to read off the sign, but I just want to first read the four drivers that are the core values of our church as a baseline. First, developing a culture of honor that fosters corporate unity among believers despite our differences. And that takes me back to our launch video when Ryan spoke and you talked about that. That, you know, we can't be unified if we can't get beyond our differences. Second, empowering followers of Christ to become true disciple makers for God's glory by becoming a part of what God is doing now in all areas of today's culture. And that really ties into the Seven Mountains focus that our church has, being the church outside of the church. Number three, equipping and empowering Christ followers to practically apply their spiritual gifts so they can take action on their God-given callings in life, like Mel just read. It's when as ministers, when we see people do that within our church and even outside of our church, it's such a great thing to see somebody recognize who they are in Christ, how God's made them, and then for them to do something with it. Number four, teaching and equipping to build greater awareness about the beauty of each of the fivefold ministry anointings through a ministry that models this leadership. And that will be really baked into a lot of what I'm talking about as we flow over the next 3 weeks. Okay? Not that I'm just focusing on that one, but that'll be central to a lot of what I'm talking about. I wanted to get one thing kind of out of the way first. And I'll hold back some things that I feel like I want to say them today, but I'm going to wait until next week. But one general thing, we're not, and I know that I've had Ryan look over all this, so we're unified in this, as well as with Pastor Phil. In when you look at the church, and I hate even labels, but you know, a more conservative evangelical church, a charismatic church, in terms of the expression of how they flow and operate, you would see, I hate to use even the word more liberal, but we don't believe in every teaching and every wind of teaching that blows through town. We're not going to subscribe to those things. But if we see a biblical support for a thing, we will. And it doesn't matter if it's easily defined or fully understood, because no man can completely, with our limited human thinking, no one of us can fully describe all of who God is and all of what he can do. So what we're contending for as we speak through this series is to again show you what we're not for and what we are for. But the reality is that through the Holy Spirit, he'll reveal more to us when we're obedient to him. And this year is the year of greater surrender. So that means following him anywhere where he leads us. Okay? But again, I just say that because I'll get there at a different point, but we desire to safeguard a people. We don't want to teach things to you that truly aren't biblical. And I've been in gatherings of Christians where I've sat present to things that I felt like was not biblical. So we do want to safeguard you in that, but we never, ever want to attempt to put the Holy Spirit in a box as if we even could. Our heart as a ministry is to trust God and to operate in the same manner as we lead you, as Psalms 32:8 says. And I don't think I actually put this one on screen, but I'll double check anywhere. Nope. Okay. It reads as follows. I'm reading out of the NIV. I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye upon you. And so that's our desire as we look at you, as we meet with you outside of church, as we meet with you for breakfast, as we bump into you on Thursday nights. Whatever it is, we want to do it with our loving eye on you. At times, anybody, including leaders, can be misunderstood, but it's we want to instruct, we want to teach, but we're doing it from a position that we love you, and we want to see you become all that God's planned you to be, truly. So some foundational stuff still. What the heck is a culture of honor? Just give some thoughts to what that could mean, because we can throw around phrases many times and really not be on the same page with what we're even talking about, sadly. We believe that the concept of a culture of honor starts from a leadership modeling this before people and then training them to do the same thing. So it's a concept where leadership teaches and displays, and the body reflects the same thing back, and we grow together. A culture of honor is created as a community of people learns to discern and receive people in their God-given identities. And realistically, it's at some level, that wasn't the exact words Mel used before he handed me the mic, but we want to see and discern how God's made you and who you are individually in Christ, and then walk with you so you can walk that out. And inside of that, there's going to be many differences amongst us, though a unifying factor of all of us in Christ. And so we want the differences of us to work, because that's how God's built the body of Christ. We're not all ears. We're not all big toes. Shame is removed through love. And we talked about it, that is what love is in Psalms 32:8. But honestly, you can't have honor present if there's shame and condemnation amongst the people. Shame tries to keep people trapped in their mistakes by convincing them that they're powerless to do anything about it. That's just kind of who they are. That's their lot in life. That's a lie from the pit of hell. At the heart of a culture of honor, there's a high value for one thing, if nothing else, freedom. There's a high value in that. When people discover their true capacity for self-control and for discipline, which is a part of the fruit of the Spirit and responsibility for how God's made them and what His purposes are for their lives, they can have revelation and opportunity they need so they can actually grow towards that freedom as His sons and daughters. And so I'm going to get to this at some point as well in this series, but there's just, sadly, there's people that are decades older than me that still, they've been walking with the Lord much longer than me, very mature in life. And I'll have one testimony of this without mentioning names, and it's not with inside our church, but they don't walk in freedom, and it's available to them. And so if we, church, can walk together in freedom and understand what that is, that Christ paid it all. He didn't pay for some of it. And we can see us as who we truly are in Christ. The identity, I know that Travis spoke about this before, just the concept of sonship. You know, if we don't have that understanding, we're going to struggle to operate in a culture of honor. Bear with me, too. Some of these things I have, I really... No, my heart, I want to get away a lot from what I prepare, but at the same time, this series is so in-depth that I want to clearly communicate. So sometimes I am going to just read things. I want to read this to you. It's about nurturing your identity from a realization of destiny. Honor is best excavated in a culture where the people know who they are, and the individual and corporate identity must be defined where? From above. It's a culture that corrects and confronts, but does not delight in punishment. It's a place with an order to things, as dictated by God's word, spirit, and presence. It is to a group of leaders whose theology is rooted in heaven, and in lieu of drawing out sound identity among believing leaders, 1 John speaks to it this way. Because of the cross, our life is no longer about trying not to sin, but about fulfilling the commandment to love. But we are successful in fulfilling the commandment to love according to the degree that we really understand and believe what the victory that Jesus won actually means. This theological understanding, which surprisingly is not broadly shared in our American culture, is big in a culture of honor because a complete understanding of the gospel forces true perspective of identity. With true identity, there will always be accountability, honesty, humility, and challenge. And that comes, not only was I referencing 1 John, but also a segment from the book by Danny Silk, Culture of Honor. First point I wanted to make is this, and these are just, again, foundational things, though I have a lot more beyond the actual points I'm going to show you in today's message. First, we can't operate in a culture of honor if we can't first operate in a pure manner. And when we think of purity, I'm thinking of the motives of your heart, why you do what you do. Do you do things to be seen by a people because you feel like you need to? Scripture gives 7 concepts to key into so we can ensure we can operate in a pure way. And I'll look to James first. Ironic, Mel, that you were there last week, but I just happened to already have this. James 3:17-18 says as follows, and this is where you're going to start to see those 7 things lifted out, and I believe they're even underlined. But the wisdom, wisdom from above is first of all pure, is also peace-loving. It's gentle at all times, not just sometimes, though it's a tough thing for us if we're honest, and willing to yield to others. So key. If we can do that, we can yield to the differences. We can yield to the differences in how God's made us, that you can see the beauty of how God's created each person really fully come alive. It is full of mercy and is full of the fruit of good deeds. It shows no favoritism. It's very easy for us to want to play favorites amongst people that are like us, that encourage us, that speak nicely to us, do things for us, if we're honest, right? And it's always sincere. And those who are peacemakers will plant seeds of peace and reap a harvest of righteousness. And I think this next scripture is actually a picture of Live with Purpose Church. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, it reads this. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from His love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate, as Emily was even praying this morning? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. At the definition of the name of our church, we believe that God has a purpose for each of our lives, but we believe He has a collective purpose for us. And how powerful would that be if we functioned like this church, that we would work together with one mind and purpose to walk in power and freedom to advance the kingdom of God. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others, though it's easy to go there. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. If we could be a people known for that, man, that would be beautiful. Don't look out for your own interests, but take interest in others too. And I've seen that in the midst of our family here, and I'm encouraged by that. I really am. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Now, I start thinking of other churches, and we were talking about us and our family and Live with Purpose Church, but another point that I wanted to make, again, just in foundation here, is we must be able to respect differences, and that includes denominations and doctrinal views, yet truly value one another to operate in a culture of honor. So when we think of the other churches in the area, I mean, the key words inside of that is value and honor. So despite the differences, do we have to agree on every single thing? Does their church have to operate from start to finish in their corporate gatherings the way we do? No. But can we value them? Can we honor them? Can we be known for that so much so that people that have different opinions still value us because of how we value and honor them? At a heart of corporate unity, that's key. And we can't function well in a culture of honor, church, if we just do it inside the walls that we meet in. We need to be able to take that outside. Where we go, we represent Christ. Where we go, we represent unity. And inside of this, again, a lot of over these next few weeks, I'm going to talk about what I do mean and what I don't mean. I'll do that a lot more next week, but just so I'm clear on this point, I'm not saying to operate under a non-biblical worldview. I'm not saying that. So again, honestly, there are churches that gather and stand for things probably that, I shouldn't say probably, I know that aren't biblical, but it's not for me to go around splinter checking. It's not for me to go and say, okay, well, I'm going to agree with what they stand for, but I can still choose to find a way to be respectful, loving, and honor them. We can major on the majors, minor on the minors, rather than majoring on the minors. We can stop focusing on these debatable matters that cause us to grumble towards our brothers and sisters in Christ, which Scripture would speak that we should not be doing that. But it's easy to do because we have certain convictions. We have things that we believe, that even perhaps the Holy Spirit showing us what is true. And I'm not saying throw out your beliefs or your convictions. But how we speak towards others that view things differently matters. Last kind of just, again, foundational brick here, no man will be able to fully understand our triune creator. We only know in part. And yet you'll have, and I guarantee you there have been many preachers, and sadly probably will continue to be, those that try to act as if they do have it all figured out. I'll tell you, I absolutely don't. 1 Corinthians, speak into this a little bit. Chapter 13, verses 9 to 12. Reads as follows. Now our knowledge is partial and incomplete. And even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of the whole picture. But when the time of perfection comes, these partial things will become useless. When I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. But we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete. But then I will know everything completely, just as God knows me completely. As I continue to go forward, I'll try to mention it probably every week, but Ryan did an awesome job in his mini-series on generous giving about encouraging questions, taking questions from our family here and responding to them. So as I say things, if you're like, what are you talking about? Or I don't even agree with that. Or that didn't make sense. I'm a little confused. Help me out. Talk with me afterwards. I really want to. And I want to, though I have everything kind of prepared, there's flexibility to take our conversations forth in the next few weeks and talk about them. Let us grow and let us learn together. So I'm going to kind of shift again into going in depth. Kids, I do have something for you here, but to be honest, it's a lot of this stuff is just, I have to get through this, so try not to fall asleep on me. All right, so what's an overview of the five anointings or the hearts in a fivefold ministry? Again, trying to not just throw out these Christianese phrases, fivefold ministry, woo, like what does that mean? What the heck are you talking about? First question is this, what is anointing? What does it mean to be anointed? I'll give you an answer. The origin of anointing was kind of a practice of shepherds. You know, a lot of times they had lice or insects that would burrow into the sheep, so much so it could get towards the sheep's ears and actually kill the sheep. So shepherds would use oil basically to make things slippery around their ears and whatnot. So it was a symbol of blessing and protection, clearly, from those that were the insects that were attacking the sheep so they would still live, and empowerment. But then when we kind of look at some of the Greek words for anoint, which are shiro, which means to smear or rub with oil, like we were just noting, and by implication, to consecrate for office or religious service, another word, alifuio, which means to anoint. In Bible times, people were anointed with oil to signify God's blessing or call on that person's life. And though I could list a whole slew of scriptures here, I won't, but a person was anointed for a special purpose. As you look at scripture, it could have been to be a king, to be a prophet, to be a builder. There was many different ways that a person was anointed. Another meaning, though, for the word anointed is chosen one. The Bible says that Jesus Christ was anointed by God with the Holy Spirit to spread the good news and free those, there's again that concept of freedom, free those who have been held captive by sin. After Christ left the earth, he gave us the Holy Spirit, which is the power that's resident within each believer. And this is the interesting point. When I look at two scriptures, 1 John 2:20, I won't put these on screen though, and 2 Corinthians 1:21 to 22, talks about this. It says, now all Christians are anointed. All Christians are anointed. Chosen for a specific purpose, hence Live With Purpose Church is very fitting, in furthering God's kingdom. It's a kingdom purpose. Now he who establishes us is with you in Christ and has anointed us in God, who has also sealed us and given us the Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. So we're all anointed. So the Holy Spirit is within us and is the guarantee. We can receive and we can hear from heavenly places and we can respond in obedience to that. And as we do that, he will reveal more. To the greater degree in which we are obedient, is to the greater degree which he will reveal his purposes and plan for our lives. Okay, so fivefold ministry: apostolic, prophetic, evangelistic, pastoral, teaching anointings, five anointings. What would be a different way to describe each of these? Apostolic, to govern. These aren't, this isn't like the only way you could communicate this, but I tried to break it down just to simplify it for us, okay? So an apostolic anointing upon a person, to govern. A prophetic anointing, to guide. An evangelistic anointing, that we're all called, Great Commission, to take the gospel forward, is to gather a people unto the Lord. A pastoral anointing, to guard, safeguard. And a teacher anointing, to ground people in truth in the Word of God. I'll give you an analogy. So picture this, might not be the most fun thing to picture, but picture a car accident. Okay? Each of these five people show up to the scene. First on the scene would be the person with the pastoral anointing, scrambling to assess if everybody's okay, begins kind of a triage approach to checking out, doing first aid to all the victims. Okay? Again, this is an analogy. I mean, they might not be skilled medically, but the pastoral anointing immediately cares for the well-being of the people. The pastor needs to know that people are healthy and strong. They know that when the gospel comes alive, the gospel comes alive when people apply and manifest true love and freedom in their lives. They focus on cultivating God's heart in people. And then second on the scene would be the person with the teacher anointing. The teacher kind of steps back for a second, studies the accident scene, checks out the skid marks, the details, what would have caused this accident. Then they would draw on their deep knowledge base of the driver's manual, which you could parallel with the Word of God, right? And having knowledge. And driving laws, and to determine who was at fault and kind of how it all happened. And then they even understand even more why true education and wisdom and understanding needs to be taught to drivers for ongoing education and teaching. Kind of catch the humor in that for a few of you. Then the next person on the scene would be the person with the evangelistic anointing. They arrive on the scene immediately asking everybody, do you know what would happen to you if you died today? They'd start with the people that looked like they were in the worst shape. And then after they would speak into that, they would go to the multitudes gathered, all the cars that pulled up to make sure everybody was okay, and they would share the same message. Because none of them, even though they drove up safe to that accident, were guaranteed to go home safe. I guarantee you that there's been accidents people have come to stop at, to help, that never made it home, if you look at history. It's a weird thought. Next, the person with the prophetic anointing would step in, and they would have already known that this was going to happen because they had a dream about it. Now, I'll go a little further. I saw this analogy, and they might not have just had a dream, but work with me. It starts to show into the dimension of how this person functions. So they had a dream about it the previous night, but they knew everybody would live in the dream. So when they walk in with power and confidence from heavenly places. They rebuke the spirit of death and declare with great faith that everyone will live and none shall die. They proclaim and pray that the eyes of the hearts of the people will be opened and that they would see in the spirit. Then they start walking around and they start declaring destiny over the lives of other people. In the midst of tragedy, they pull down measures from heaven that affect people. And then last, not that the person with the apostolic anointing was just sleeping or something, but they come in last and they pray for all the injured. They invite a supernatural healing touch of God into the scene. They begin to speak testimonies of what they've seen, the power of God move in other places and other situations, and it activates the people to believe. Hope rises because of the testimony that they share. And then they start to mobilize people praying for others. They start to grab people at the scene and they start to mobilize a more powerful move of God, having a sense and an understanding of the giftings of the people. So in doing that, it kind of draws out the diverse anointings and the gifts of people that are there, and God's really glorified in how they all work together. An example for us, Live with Purpose Church, would be this. At Fun Day, first annual Fun Day last year, I can definitely say, I remember who I was talking to, but afterwards, you could just see each of us just be who we were that day. It was awesome. And so that wasn't an accident scene. That was a time of celebration that day, and we're excited to do it again this summer. It was the same picture, you know? And I could sit back and watch people just be who they were, and it was awesome. No, I obviously was participating too, but I tend to do that. I tend to do a lot of oversight and looking. Even when service is happening, everywhere I go, I just kind of think like that. I can't help myself. Anyway, continuing on. Evan, you might like this, just in your nature of work. Plumbing. I'll give another metaphor. Another metaphor is to describe how these five anointings work really well in coalition, which is really what we're talking about, culture of honor. All these anointings upon a people working together. And again, remember, we're all anointed by God. And all filled. For those that have made Jesus Christ Lord of their lives and accepted the free gift of salvation, we all have the same Holy Spirit within us, the same power that raised Christ from the dead within us. So in that plumbing analogy, to describe how all the anointings would work in coalition, it's kind of like each piece or part of the framing of the plumbing, all working as designed. I don't know what you call it, but that sealant you put on them and all these things. You know that there's going to be leaks and chaos if it's not all working the way it's designed. But when it works the way it's designed, we show up and turn on faucets and do things and it's beautiful, have nice showers or whatever. But it's functioning as designed. I don't know all the pieces of plumbing, so I'm not even going to go there. But if all those five are working together, we can see that. That when we do that, we can be pulling down things from heaven. We can be functioning. We can be a measurement of the operation of heaven in earthly places where we function and live. I wanted to give the analogy or maybe examples for the youth that are here, for kids with purpose. How can you engage in this stuff that I'm talking about? First, with the apostolic anointing, you can honor God's appointed leaders and authority that he's placed in your life. I've seen that. The youth that we've had here have been amazing. So by continuing to do that, why is that important? He will build you up. He will grow you. He will make you stronger and more capable. I say some of these things to you, youth, because you don't need to wait till you're a certain age. Be who you are in Christ now. Prophetic anointing. And for some of you, you might even be wondering, like, how has God made me? You know, speak to your parents about it. Speak to us as leaders about it. We have ways that we can measure this, but you know, there is gifting within you. Recognize that God can give you words, pictures, dreams, or visions that you're meant to share with others. So when you think of the prophetic, you might have something, Jacob, one day that you're supposed to share to Elijah. And you might be like, I don't know why I have this thing. It just keeps coming back to you. It might be that God wants you to share it with him. And if you're not sure, share it with your parents. See what they feel. Pray with them. But God can use you to speak these things over others. Evangelistic anointing. You could share what Jesus has done in your life or in the life of your family. And your words and testimonies can be used to lead others to Christ, be it in school, be it wherever. Skateboarding, doesn't matter. Okay? Again, there's no junior Holy Spirit. Pastoral anointing. You can look out for the well-being of the other youth in this ministry or outside of this ministry and talk to them when you see them not honoring God, when you see them making choices that are not honoring God, which I guarantee you at times will happen. Offer to pray with them and continue to pray for them. That's what you can be doing in that. And in that, you can be caring for them with the same heart of a pastoral anointing. Teacher anointing. You can have the opportunity to be teaching assistants in Kids with Purpose if you have a passion for that. We would love to empower you as the Holy Spirit works. So share it with your parents or one of the leaders if you'd like to be more involved. We're not afraid of that. Talk to us. Okay, so I'm going to give a little bit of biblical foundation here. We're going to hit some scriptures for the fivefold ministry. And see how I can go with time here. I'll try to pick up some speed. So I just simply want to challenge you to look at the word. So if you can, write some of these down even after today or listen to it again online. See what you see as you look at these scriptures. I'm just trying to communicate what I believe I've seen. and ask the Holy Spirit to reveal truth to you. When I, an interesting thought, though, for those that would believe more in a cessationist point of view, that there were the 12 apostles, and now that's long since gone. Interesting, when you look at Scripture, that there's literally, I found at least 22 in there. Some of them were Matthias, Barnabas, Paul, Titus, Timothy, Silas, James, Apollos, and there's actually a few more. So I don't know what you do with that, but for me, I can't see it being dead or done. And when I look at Scripture, I'm going to go into 1 Corinthians, actually the King James Version in this one, chapter 12, verses 27 to 28, reads, "Now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular, and God hath set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, governments, and diversities of tongues." I believe God's a God of order. I believe I see order in that. I believe I see order in that even back to an older translation. And when I look forward in a lot of other translations, I see the same thing. I don't see that one translation just spun it that way. I look at the Amplified version of that, which I love because it takes it and basically it's almost like a sponge that grows. "Now you collectively are Christ's body, and individually you are members of it, each with its own special purpose and function. So God has appointed and placed in the church for his own use, first apostles, chosen by Christ, second prophets, those who foretell the future, those who speak a new message from God to the people, third, teachers, then those who work miracles, then those with the gifts of healing, the helpers, the administrators, and speakers in various kinds of unknown tongues." Book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verses 10 to 12. "And the same one who descended is the one who ascended higher than all the heavens, so that he might fill the entire universe with himself. Now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ." Interesting, again, the ordering. As I look at a lot of these scriptures, and again, we'll get into this in upcoming weeks, but I look at the ordering of this, pastors and teachers always towards the back side of this. Different translation, again, Amplified version. Same scriptures. "He who descended is the very same as he who has ascended high above all the heavens, that he, his presence, might fill all things," not some things, "that is the whole universe. And his gifts to the church were varied, and he himself appointed some as apostles or special messengers and representatives, some as prophets who speak a new message from God to the people, some as evangelists who spread the good news of salvation, and some as pastors and teachers to shepherd and guide and instruct. And he did this to fully equip and perfect the saints," God's people, us, "for works of service to build up the body of Christ, the church." And we look further in Ephesians, a couple more, chapter 2, verses 20. "Together we are his house, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets." I'm going to get in a lot more on that next in the next 2 weeks. "And the cornerstone is Christ Jesus himself." That never changes. It's always been true, always will be. If that was the foundation then, why has man changed this? It's a question to wrestle with. When I look at the order and the fact that this is what it was like from the beginning, why would the structure, the function, and the flow of the church change? Unless Scripture gave us clarity on that. I'm not going to, you can just cite this verse, it's too long, I didn't put it on screen, but Ephesians 3, 14 to 12. I'm going to read out the Amplified. "By referring to this, when you read it, you can understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which in other generations was not disclosed to mankind, as it is now, as it has now been revealed by his holy apostles and prophets by the Holy Spirit. It is this, that the Gentiles are now joint heirs with the Jews, that we can all know Christ and are members of the same body and joint partakers sharing in the same divine promise of Christ Jesus through their faith in the good news of salvation. Of this gospel, I was made a minister by the saints, God's people. I was made a minister by the gift of God's grace given me, through the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, God's people, this grace, which is undeserved, was graciously given to proclaim to the Gentiles the good news of the incomprehensible riches of Christ, that spiritual wealth which no one can fully understand, as we mentioned before, and to make plain to everyone the plan of the mystery regarding the unity of believing Jews and Gentiles in one body, which until now was kept hidden through the ages in the mind of God who created all things. So now, through the church, the multifaceted wisdom of God, which I would see as this, the beauty of this fivefold ministry, in all the countless aspects might now be made known, revealing the mystery to the angelic rulers and authorities in heavenly places. This is according to the terms of the eternal purpose which he carried out, Father God, in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and confidence access through faith in him. That is, our faith gives us sufficient courage to freely and openly approach God through Christ. Winding down, just a couple concluding thoughts. Quick video. I think we can still do it. And then just know, I had a lot to dump today. Picture me like Ryan's company just pouring concrete right now. That's all I'm doing. This is just a lot of concrete. It's going to get a lot more flexible, and we're going to go in a different angle in the next 2 weeks, but I needed to get this stuff out. Couple things. People definitely in the church are so afraid of holy fire that they settle for no fire. I don't want that. I don't want anything to do with that. But that's true when we look at the people around us. So we need to speak out. If you don't want that to be you, church, you need to speak out and live out of your true identity in Christ. Stop cheapening the gospel and what Christ did by not seeing, believing, and walking the authority of Christ that is available to you as you live, as you minister, as you grow in your walk with God. And we're all at different places, but we're all meant to grow from the point where we are. These are some of the things that the Word says about us. That the same power that raised Christ from the dead is in you, not just me, in each of us. We're co-heirs with Christ. We're more than conquerors. We're a royal priesthood. God's chosen people who are what? Set apart for His glory. Amen. We're empowered by the Holy Spirit. We don't just know of the Holy Spirit. We're empowered by the Holy Spirit. We can walk in the authority of Christ. And this one's key. We can actually change atmospheres as we walk into them. As we bring the light of the gospel with us, the room should change, even if we say nothing. This is what Scripture testifies of who we are. Now, there's a quick testimony. One other point, the video. Pray for you guys. You're out of here. This. I can't wait till we go across the street in some ways, just because I'm never going to have to crush and rush down to the finish line. But anyway. Different sermon, different day. So, there's this guy. Last week, a bivocational pastor, loved the guy. He went off in this thing, and we were just talking about sermons for an hour, even though I was supposed to be coaching him. And I love talking about God, so it didn't really matter. And Mennonite church, and he was just talking about this other guy that's like kind of, I'll say like Donnie or Mel, an older man in the church that's well-respected that is preaching. And he's saying stuff that this pastor wanted to just fall out of his seat. And he found himself like correcting him. It would be almost like as I'm preaching, Mel, you're just like stood up and be like, Brother Joe, like, don't say that. Like, well, I can't believe you're saying that. But the guy, I'm going to use this label, unintentional false humility. I mean, false humility is one thing where You're really, from the motives of your heart, you're not really being humble. You're just trying to paint some picture as if you are. But unintentional false humility is more this, where this man was speaking, and I think it was just kind of like he never got a hold of what's available to him. All these things that I just said about what Scripture says we are. He was like, well, one day I will attain this identity in Christ. Like, he was saying things where it's like, no, man, like, you are that now. Now. And like, I know that in this Mennonite pastor, he was struggling because he, as we talk, I would use different phrases, and you could tell he was like, yeah, Holy Spirit, there's something there. He's trying to figure it out. But the same Holy Spirit's there within him and I, and though he would use different words, he just knew that this man was not speaking out of the fullness that was there, and it was breaking his heart. This man settled for no fire in his own life. And he I don't believe he meant any wrong in doing that. Again, just as a reminder, and I want to play that if you can get the video ready. Just as a general statement, I'm going to use a lot of more teaching in these next couple of weeks, but I don't want you to ever feel like, and I'm going to give you examples even, I'm going to have other people share testimonies of when they've gotten into really weird situations, and they're like, well, that was weird. That didn't feel like that was God. That was like man like doing something very odd, and it felt weird. We're not going to subscribe to every teaching that blows through town. I guarantee you at some level, some churches will look, if they would go on our website, they look at what we stand for. People will have problems with some of the things that we stand for. I've already had conversations with people that have communicated this, and yet if we believe that there has biblical basis to it, we don't want to limit God, but we want to safeguard you guys effectively. As we think of that in your obedience, as you flow through each of your days, if you're willing to follow the Holy Spirit anywhere, each day, He can change you. He can use you, and He desires to in powerful ways. Can you cue up the video, please? It's actually a different video, same words you would have seen before.
This isn't working and this isn't worth it. Another voice rises to remind you that the same power, the same strength, the same Spirit that raised the Savior from a borrowed grave is alive and active in you. The same God who delivered you from the lion and the litter can and will deliver this new giant into your hands. So draw the line. Take your stand. Just like you wielded your weapons last time, do it again. The battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. And if He caused you to triumph back then, be confident, He'll do it again. Yesterday, today, and forever, Jesus Christ is the same. In His name, you are unstoppable. But receiving this promise requires perseverance. I know sometimes it's hard to keep it moving, when you can't see your progress, when you've lost your perspective, when the pain has pushed you past your breaking point. But this is no time to tap out, because the end of yourself is the beginning of Him. So fix your focus, wake your courage, stir your confidence, and do it again. Set your face like flint with determination, and declare, I will do it again. When it doesn't make sense, I'll do it again. When I have to go against the wind, I'll do it again. When all hell is breaking loose, when it feels like home has disappeared from the horizon, and I've waited for rain, but I don't see any signs. I will look again, lifting my
What I liked about the use of that video is it, and I, for those, hopefully you could see it all, but there were so many people, ages, situations, children, moms, just across the board. It really covered, you know, an older person with physical therapy. I've gotten to know some of the struggles in your lives, and I look forward to getting to know more, where we can trust one another to get into these things so we can pray at a deeper level. But God's not changed. He desires to do something amazing through us, but we have to be willing to surrender everything, to follow Him anywhere. If we're able to do that collectively, church, I believe this year we're going to start seeing things that shock us. In our individual lives, He's going to use us in ways that we didn't have a grid for. He's going to do something with us as a church that's going to be pretty cool. Let me just pray over you guys. Father, we are thankful for today, God. We are thankful that we could begin this journey. And I just pray, Holy Spirit, that You would speak to Your people, that You would give them a deep passion this week to study out the scriptures we talked about. We pray, God, that You would challenge them to go back when the video is up in the next day or so to look at it again, God. We just pray that they would do that, that we could just stir one another up, that we could have conversation, God. And as we go into these next couple weeks, that anything that's been prepared, that You would redirect as You see fit, God. That You would just build us, train us, show us how to surrender all areas. Show us to walk out with authority that is available through You, Christ Jesus. That You have paid it all, that we are who You say we are, not who we say we are. Help us to live in such a way where people that don't know You want to know You. We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right, well, go in peace. If you can come to the underground, we'll love to see you over there. Thanks for sticking with me, and look forward to seeing you next week if you can be back. Love you guys.